I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints from the Minnesota State Fair. My co-host today is Joan Willshire. She recently attended an event in White Bear Lake on the new Bear Tracks autonomous vehicle system and spoke with Transportation Commissioner Nancy Daubenberger. My special guest today is none other than Jerry Hammer, the Executive Director of the Minnesota State Fair. We're going to have some Minnesota State Fair information and some transportation information all coming up next on Disability Viewpoints State Tour.
The future of transportation is here. Minnesota is exploring how connected and automated vehicles, known as CAV, might impact how we travel. But what does that mean? What are connected and automated vehicles? Connected vehicles use technology, such as cell phone apps, to communicate with other vehicles, connect with traffic signals, signs, bicyclists, pedestrians, and much more, and to gather data to help make roads safer and to improve the flow of traffic. Automated vehicles also use technology to do driving tasks like steer, accelerate, or brake with little to no human input. CAV vehicles can have connected technology, automated technology, or both. The MedCity Mover in Rochester, Minnesota, is an example of a CAV that is literally on the road. People are transported by a highly automated vehicle that uses many different technologies like GPS, light-based radar, and cellular technology to operate on a pre-programmed route. The shuttles can detect vehicles, people walking or bicycling, and other objects on the roadway, and makes adjustments accordingly, like safely stopping. It's one of the research and demonstration projects planned by the Minnesota Department of Transportation to ensure the technology works well for all people in all conditions, including Minnesota's snowy winters. You can learn more about this revolutionary technology, demonstration projects in the state, and more by heading to our website, MnDOT.gov/automated.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for coming out for this. It's great to be here today to talk about our exciting new pilot project, the Bear Tracks Self-Driving Shuttle. I'm Nancy Daubenberger. I'm the Commissioner of the Minnesota Department of Transportation. And this is an exciting day for transportation in Minnesota. The Bear Tracks Shuttle project is one that is the first self-driving shuttle in the Twin Cities. The first pilot project that we had was the MedCity Mover project in Rochester, and that was the first one in the state, but this one is going to certainly build on what we're learning from MedCity. MnDOT's Connected and Automated Vehicle Office, or what we call at MnDOT the CAV office, is leading the way to prepare our state for the future of transportation. And this project is a great example of providing a safe alternative transportation choice, particularly for those who might have mobility issues.
Yeah, I'm Corey Johnson, MnDOT's project manager. On the technology side, you'll see most of the tech is going to be embodied in that machine right behind me, the shuttle. It's a slow speed, 15 mile an hour, it's 11 person shuttle. It runs on electricity, battery powered, and it runs on a predefined route. So on that route, we actually have it starting right here. And the operators, you'll see a safety operator is gonna help you and be on board and monitor and make everything go all right. But I'll turn it over to Sherry Wilson, I'm the executive director from the Chamber.
Hi there, I'm Sherry Wilson with the executive director of the White Bear Area Chamber of Commerce. As business advocates, we are optimistic that connected and automated vehicles will have the potential to connect people to jobs, customers to businesses, as well as move goods efficiently about our transportation system. Additionally, by working with our local educators, we are excited to introduce this technology to students, ensuring workforce of tomorrow is prepared for the jobs of the future.
Well, good afternoon. I am really pleased and excited to be here today. This is such an important step into the future as we look at things. The environment and what we are trying to do, the mobility for people along this line to be able to get to the YMCA and to be able to get out and move around a little bit. I mean, that's really what we're talking about here. But I am especially excited about the environmental aspects of this and what it means to the future. But this automated shuttle, I think, is going to be just a tremendous opportunity to learn and to then expand into other parts of this area and across the country, really. And I am now very excited to introduce another partner in all of this with the City of White Bear Lake, Dan Lewis-Smith, the Mayor of White Bear Lake.
Thank you, Commissioner. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dan Lewis-Smith, Mayor of White Bear Lake, and I just want to welcome you to White Bear Lake. This is a beautiful small town, and projects like this, and I'll get into it in a little bit, and the partnerships that make it possible are what we pride ourselves on in White Bear Lake and bringing private and public entities together to make things happen. I do want to extend a special thank you to MnDOT for putting your trust in White Bear Lake to be a good partner and make this project a great success, and I'm sure it will be. I'm particularly excited to hear the feedback from residents. It's such a new technology and it's going to be foreign to so many people, and it's opportunities like this are so few far in between for the residents to be able to experience this. So I would welcome the residents of White Bear Lake and those from surrounding communities that come to White Bear to try this out, to tell us how it's going. I want to hear the good, the bad, what can we do to improve it. I think technology like this really is the future, particularly for small quaint towns like ours, to provide this sort of intra-transportation opportunities for residents. And lastly, before we kick things off with the first inaugural rides, I want to thank a couple of the key partners that really made this possible. New Tracks has been instrumental in providing the logistics and are really the ones that are going to be handling the day-to-day coordination of these rides. It's going to be housed at their facility, and we couldn't have done it without New Tracks, so we thank you for your partnership. And lastly, I do want to extend another thank you to Commissioner Daubenberger, who has took the time out of her busy schedule to be here today and help us with this launch. We thank you for being here. And with that, I will turn it back over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Lewis-Smith. And just to underscore something the mayor said too, this project cannot succeed without riders. It is an opportunity for us to learn more about providing this type of service, the shuttle service, automated vehicles, and really important. So please help us get the word out so we can get more community members and then those who come to the community riding the shuttle and providing us that input. We have many important decisions ahead and we very much want to hear from you. So thank you very much again for coming out today. Thank you for the work you'll do to spread the word. And with that, we're going to open it up to questions. And I'm going to have our project manager, Corey Johnson, come back up.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of special mapping on that. And we've been spending some time here in the last month getting all that set up and getting that route actually mapped out. Absolutely, yeah. The schedule will be posted on the website. But as a routine, it will be Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1:30.
With that, why don't we go ahead and wrap and any other instructions?
We have a quick ribbon cutting and then we'll be, again, available for rides on the shuttle. What we'd like to do with the first one is open that up primarily to the media folks, if we could, and then it'll circle back around and we'll get the rest of the media on it. And then
welcome, Commissioner Daubenberger.
Thank you, Joan.
Well, I want to say congratulations, too, on the new appointment to Commissioner of the Department of Transportation in Minnesota.
Thank you.
Exciting times.
These are very exciting times to be in transportation. There's
absolutely
a lot going on.
And as we all know, without transportation, you're not going anywhere, right?
That's right.
Well, and today's an exciting day because we're doing another pilot, right, on the autonomous vehicle coming to a road near us in Minnesota.
That's correct. This is the Bear Tracks project here in White Bear Lake.
Fabulous.
And this is the second automated shuttle project in the state, but the first one in the Twin Cities and in a suburban area. So the MedCity Mover in Rochester is right in the urban downtown core,
sure.
But this is out in the suburbs. So it's going to be a little bit different type of route and making a number of stops for those who we anticipate will want to use this sort of technology.
Sure.
We're hoping we get a lot of use as a pilot project and good input from the experiences.
Right.
All the types of experiences that are had, we want to know how that goes. That's kicking off today and it will go over the course of this following year. So from today till next August of 23.
Wow, that's fantastic. So it sounds like between the two projects from Rochester to White Bear, we're really looking at the difference between the inner city and then now looking at more of the suburb type scenario.
That's correct. Yes, we've learned a lot already from the MedCity Mover project in Rochester, gotten a lot of data from that. And now this project then dovetails from that out here in the suburban area.
Well, I do know from the Rochester project that the number one concern, maybe even the complaint, was it went too slow. So are we picking up the speed at all here in the suburbs?
This shuttle will be going 12 to 15 miles per hour, so it goes rather slowly, but it does make its way around the loop quite well. It was about a 20-minute loop course that we were on with a few different stops. We didn't make all the stops on our first test sure. run, but it does move along, and it seems to, as a somebody experiencing it myself, just from my experience, I would say it seemed like a good speed for interacting with traffic and being a new technology out there.
Is it going to have to learn how to drive through the roundabouts that you have up here?
Not on this course. Okay. However, the technology will need to advance to right. being able to navigate different types of road geometry.
That'll be an interesting scenario when putting the autonomous vehicles out trying to do the roundabouts, that's for sure. What are some other things that you're looking to actually learn throughout this pilot besides the differences between the inner city and the suburbs?
Well, one thing we want to learn from piloting this technology in Minnesota is how it performs in different weather extremes. So in Minnesota, we have weather like we have today where it's hot, humid. We have some pretty sophisticated sensors that need to perform in that sort of extreme. But then also when we have the very cold weather, how it's going to perform, how the battery, it's a battery powered technology sure. for moving the shuttle and how that battery is going to perform in different weather extremes as well. And then with the winter weather too, when it snows, how it performs in detecting snow or slippery conditions, that sort of thing. So these are other data points we're going to be collecting.
And I'm assuming, we know the vehicle is fully accessible, which is fantastic for people with disabilities and aging individuals as well. Are you looking to generate a different population during this pilot, perhaps, than what you had encountered in Rochester?
Yeah, as you mentioned, those with disabilities or our aging population, but also our younger population who isn't driving yet, or those who just choose not to drive for whatever reason, to have a different technology available to them to be able to get where they need to go. We want to have it available to all. We want all sorts right. of different riders to be riding it, trying it out, and giving us that input.
Right. So it sounds like there's not a lot of difference between the two pilots, just really this different geographic, so to speak, area too.
Different geographic area, right. And then, you know, also the population, it'll be interesting to see as people are providing input, their backgrounds are, and what their thoughts are on it. It might be different between the two different locations.
Is there anything you'd like to say to the community, for people with disabilities in particular, about a message for them when we're looking now at autonomous vehicles as a means of coming and going?
Yes, certainly. It is important for all Minnesotans to be able to have access to transportation and get to where they need to be. And that is part of why we want to make sure we're advancing technology to be able to provide that. And I'd also just like to add, really want people to get out and try this out and then give us that input.
Right. So that's the message. Get out, come out, try it out. Give some comment, I would imagine.
Come out to White Bear Lake, try riding the shuttle, and provide us that input. That's what we need to know where to go as we advance this technology.
Well, that's fantastic. I think this is going to be a huge game changer for people with disabilities in particular, be able to live, work, and play in their community and get to where they need to go. So it's fantastic. So I'm thrilled to see it moving and moving forward. So thanks again for coming on the show and basically telling us what to expect in the days to come with this autonomous vehicle in White Bear Lake.
Thank you, Joan. Thanks for having us sure. here today.
Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to the special edition Disability Viewpoint from the Minnesota State Fair. With me is none other than our boss at the State Fair, Jerry Hammer.
Mark, so nice to see you again.
And today we're going to talk about safety, security, and accessibility. And we'll get all that done by the time we're done today. And there's lots of things to talk about at the State Fair because there's a lot of new things happening. Jerry, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, Mark. It's always so nice to be here and be part of the program.
Good, nice to have you. The first thing, because it's been in the news, is security. There's been a lot of changes in a very short time. And let's talk and bring people up to speed. We're back to our own security department here at the State Fair.
We are, but you know, in the much bigger picture, if I look at how things have evolved, my time in this job now has been, it's 26 years, which is hard to believe, but when I look back at what security was at that time and the different security measures we were taking then, it was just a small fraction of where we are today. And things have changed greatly, even in the last few years, as things in the world change, as you know, things that give people concern, you know, wherever they go. We've seen so much of that everywhere, and it's not just here, it's all over North America. Actually, it's all over the world. And because of that, we have changed our systems dramatically. In between 2019, the last year, there was a fair. We didn't have a fair in 2020, but between 2019 and 21, we doubled our public safety and security expense. We went from close to $2 million, and right now we're pushing $4 million. But there are just things that we need to do, and a lot of what we see is more technology on the grounds, more relationships with safety and security agencies, law enforcement. Not just here, not just in the Twin Cities, but you know, statewide, regionally, and also at the federal level, with Homeland Security, FBI's involved, Bureau of Criminal Apprehension. It's a huge network, and all are very closely involved in providing a security plan here.
And also the reason that this is so important is that once the Minnesota State Fair closes down as the State Fair, there are a lot of other activities of which the grounds are used for throughout the year, so it's an ongoing process,
right?
And it has to be right up to speed, right up to the minute, and I know that. Now, as far as accessibility, there's a lot of great things that go on here too, as far as updating the buildings, and we have two drop-offs for Metro Mobility, which is the great thing, and things like that. Anything you want to add there?
Well, it's a process, and this is one of those cases where we have a road that we're traveling, but you never arrive at the destination because there's always more you can do, and we're very aware of again more changes and just more ability to do things. You know, when I look back to when we just got going with accessibility, a lot of it, most of it, had to do with mobility. So then we're talking about curb cuts and accessible restrooms and all those things, but it actually, you know, it goes way beyond that. And now we have services for people with vision challenges, with blind and limited vision.
For
we have exactly, yeah, there are plenty of facilities here. We wheelchair scooter rental available. There's a lot of folks. Well, my brother is a good example. He had a stroke in December, and he's recovering just fine. He's working really hard at it. But he will need some help getting around. So there's a good example of, you know, someone who kind of new to the whole world, but he needs it. Yeah, well, he's doing fine. He's doing really well. But it does create a need to take a little different look at things and just how you get around and what you do. Last year we added Fraser Sensory. Not an exhibit, it's actually a center for people, right? And we're expanding now this year, so it's not just the sensory center. All of our staff are getting tip sheets on how to help and be more aware, and that applies basically to everything. There's a whole lot going on that you wouldn't see unless you really looked hard for it, but we're doing a lot of what we can.
Obviously, the Fraser Center found great benefit in it because they want to expand too.
You want to expand so all parties are satisfied.
Right. But, you know, and that's very similar to our overall accessibility program. There's always more you can do. You know, whatever you're doing, you find more. You just want to be as comprehensive as you can. You know, because ultimately the fair is about everybody. It's for everybody. And everybody makes up the fabric of Minnesota. So what can we do? What do we need to do to make sure everybody can have a great time at the fair? And that's really what it's all about.
And as advanced as technology has been and continues to be, you're always updating that also. And so we want to talk about what technological advances there are at the fair for the hearing impaired, the vision impaired, everybody concerned.
There's a lot of info on our website. Thanks for asking, Mark. MNstatefair.org.
One more time.
MNstatefair.org.
And probably the biggest piece is everybody's safety. And that's from if you should need an ambulance, if you could become, I hate to mention it on a beat show, but if you become all of a sudden ill, what kind of safety can we expect? We want everybody to be safe. We want everybody to walk in groups, probably, and wheel in groups. But what as far as our safety, our health and wellness and welfare at the state fair, what can we expect?
The first thing you'd see right away, and they're very visible, EMT service provided by St. Paul Fire Department.
Right.
Those folks are outstanding. We just did a National Night Out was recently, and firemen show up. They bring a truck, and all of them, they discovered I work at the fair, so that became part of the discussion. And they work here as well, and they're really good, and they're really visible. If something came up, if there was a need for some kind of medical attention, they would be here literally within a couple of minutes, you know, at the most. They're that good. We also work with Regents Hospital in case transport is needed. We have two first aid stations on the fairgrounds in the case that it's not a real demanding emergency, but you need a little help.
Yep.
And our public safety and police officers, there's hundreds of them all over the grounds. And they're here ready to handle anything that would come up.
And then our security as far as police force is in-house, but who would... It's our own State Fair police force again?
It is. The State Fair has the ability and actually did run our own police department for decades. 2021 was a little different story after being out of business in shutdown in 2020. The following year we had very little time. We didn't really know there'd even be a fair until the end of May. We didn't know what it might look like until June. So thankfully Ramsey County stepped in and Sheriff Fletcher to provide outstanding security. And also the State Patrol. Minnesota State Patrol is now involved as well. And they have officers, and they'll be here this year to supplement our own State Fair Police Department.
Great, so you have kind of a backup.
They're part of the team. Yep. You know, and again, we look beyond that. It's not just the fairgrounds itself. It's neighborhood, neighboring communities, and a cooperative effort by our own police department along with neighboring police departments. And actually at this moment we have 57 different law enforcement agencies that are represented in our own police department. And then you add
Homeland
in
Homeland Security also.
Homeland Security right at the federal level, Homeland Security, FBI, Minnesota Bureau of Criminal Apprehension, sheriff's departments, every place, security contractors, you know, different private entities are operating metal detectors at all our gates, and it's just a very broad coalition of public safety agencies, law enforcement agencies, and security companies.
So if you're coming out, don't worry, be happy. You'll always be safe, and they strive here to make all of that possible. Is there any final words in that you'd like to say?
We're just so glad this year, leading up to the fair, starting even last winter, was the first time in over 2 years that things actually felt more normal. Coming out of the pandemic year, and then the challenges we faced last year, this year, for the first time, feels normal, and we're just so happy for that.
Yeah, that's great. And from a personal standpoint, this has to be a thrill for you still after all these years, 26 of them, to start up again and have a normal running operation.
I grew up about a block away, right back there. And I thought every fair was like this. And, you know, when I got my first taste that it wasn't, I was in the fourth grade and the family drove to the Black Hills and we drove by South Dakota State Fairgrounds, which are, you know, they're nice, but they're absolutely nothing like this. Maybe 10% of the size and no permanent building. So it took a while for me to realize how special this place really is. But every year that goes by, it just gets more and more special.
I got some great memories here too. And Jerry, as always, thank you for what you've done. Is there anything we missed before we go?
No, we're just looking forward to having everybody at the fair this year, and we'll do everything we can to make sure everybody has a great time.
Absolutely. Thanks for being on the show today, Jerry.
Oh, thanks so much, Mark.
We'll talk again soon, okay?
Thanks, Mark.
Jerry Hammer, our director at the Minnesota State Fair, and I'm Mark Hughes. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints in just a moment. That's going to do it for us today on Disability Viewpoints. The bear tracks, autonomous vehicles, and the interview with Commissioner Nancy Daubenberger was certainly interesting, and we'd like to thank Joan Willshire for being our co-host today, but I especially want to thank Jerry Hammer. We did our shoot at the Minnesota State Fair without pork chops on a stick, without Sweet Martha's cookies, without all the popcorn and kettle corn that there is to go with it. Well, we hope during the Minnesota State Fair that you'll take the information that we've delivered today and put it to good use and visit us at the Minnesota State Fair coming up real soon. We want you to stop by and eat all those treats and have a lot of fun. We'll see you at the fair. For Disability Viewpoints, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.